And Ningaloo was recently listed as a World Heritage Site because of its outstanding values, including all the larger megafauna and all of the smaller animals and corals that make up the whole system. It's certainly an area that pretty much every visitor that comes here walks away saying, please don't change it. We want to keep it the way it is. We'd like it to be that way when we come back next time. And luckily, with the system of marine parks that we have here currently, we're pretty well placed to do that. When I first started swimming with mantas, I was blown away by their size, their grace, their intellect. I realised that they didn't have a great deal of protection and there wasn't a lot known about them at the time. So I started doing some informal research into mantas that we had here. That's now 12 years ago. We've been using the unique pattern on their bellies to identify them. I've been lucky enough that I get to name quite a few, as others do. One of the first mantas and the most resident or the most commonly seen manta that we have here, I was lucky enough to name after my mum, so her name's Isabel. Of the over 750 animals that we've identified so far, every single one of them has visited not only Ningaloo but these sanctuary zones close to Coral Bay. Not all of them come back every year, but there are a number that we would call reef resident. In most cases, these are breeding mature females that eke out an existence within these sanctuary zones and the broader area. If we change that, we may potentially decrease their effectiveness of breeding and living their lives. So it's quite important to protect them, to keep them coming back and keep the introductions of new manta rays to the area.
Around Australia, in the large states that have a well-established marine park network now, about 5% of the coast is in sanctuary zone. They allow us to protect the really vulnerable species, but at the same time, they're generally a big experiment, really, to actually just see through time what a natural process looks like and what natural abundances of many of our typical species are in the absence of fishing pressure.
You know, people have got this idea in their head that they think the bottom of the ocean is just littered with fish. Well, it's not, you know. The way I try and explain it to people is that the ocean's a desert. There's just a few spots where the fish hang out, and they're the spots that we fish.
I've been up in the northwest for 50 years, and you could just sit on the water's edge and fish would be swimming between your legs. And just in that short space of time, I've noticed how the opportunity to catch a fish off the beach has diminished significantly.
Well, I think marine parks are very important for the conservation of our marine environment. They are conserving the country just as my people were doing for thousands of years.
There's a very long history, going back a couple of hundred years at least, of fisheries overexploitation. People used to fish, you know, off the beach and catch heaps, and then after a while they had to go further afield, and as the boats have got bigger and better and our technology has improved, it's allowed us to go further and further into the ocean.
You hear some of the old school stories of the locals that first came into the bay in the 60s and 70s, and the fish life that was there was just amazing. Now it's getting harder and harder. A few of the old school locals were, you know, the old anecdote of back in my day really does pull a bit of weight in this area. When I first started on the boat, 70, 80 metres was pretty deep. Now we're regularly out in 130s. It's basically just the pressure since town's been opened up. There's a lot more pressure getting put on the reef now. At some point, anyone that owns a boat and has a family is going to come to the Ningaloo coast and try and wet a line. There's a lot of people that will just come into town to get their 20 kilos of fillets each. And a lot of them don't leave until they have it.
We know that the system has been changed by people. We know that our land use is changing the system. There's runoff, there's problems with that. We know that there's the impacts of cyclones and storms and the escalating effects of climate change, which are becoming more and more apparent. So marine reserves, by setting areas aside, are actually allowing to restore places to something resembling what a natural system should look like.
As far as sanctuary zones go, you're very rarely giving up much. And really, for me, that's an insurance policy. To have an area that's natural, that allows us to understand what a natural process is, so we can much better manage the vast majority of the area you are actually fishing in. So through time, we've been involved in this research now over 25 odd years. The initial research we undertook in Tasmania is we've now spread across a whole range of temperate Australian states, including Western Australia, South Australia, Victoria, New South Wales. So we've been able to gather a real wealth of information on the kinds of changes that happen in response to protection in marine parks. So one of the first big changes we saw was at Maria Island, a marine park on the eastern side of Tasmania. So within a few years of protection, we had really big increases in some species of fish and a big increase in rock lobster. So that was sort of an exciting first result. But it was quite surprising, I guess, the extent the lobsters recovered. Within 10 years, the biomass of lobsters had gone up nearly 20 times. So this huge abundance of lobsters, and not just numbers of them, but the sizes. So they'd gone up from quite small lobsters up to monsters that were 3 or 4 plus kilograms in weight.
The marine park zones are definitely spill out areas, so it's very good areas to fish and certainly very healthy populations of what we're after. About 28 years ago, I began commercial lobster fishing, and back then there was no quota introduced, and so everyone used to hard slog and catch as many as they could. I think when we manage fisheries, sustainability is the most important thing. If a fishery wasn't sustainable, we shouldn't be fishing it. So I think with a correct balance between marine parks and also quotering species, it's good for future generations.
For a long time, it's either fisheries management or marine reserves. It's not the two coming together. I think we're past that now. We know what reserves can do, particularly for targeted species. We know what effective fishery management does. Why not use the two things? Let's bring it together. It doesn't have to be one or the other. We can get some conservation benefits. We can allow stocks to build up within the reserves, and we can help to boost the sustainability of the fishery. This monitoring program that we have on these inshore reefs has been running for about 14 years, and we're currently out there for about 60 to 100 days a year surveying the fish and coral communities. In the last 6 weeks, we've done approaching 100 dives, so we've spent about 150 hours in the water. We're lucky enough to work in some of the most beautiful places. In Queensland, we obviously have this iconic Great Barrier Reef Marine Park. Within that marine park, we've got about 33% of the total area protected within no-take marine reserves. Those areas are spread around coral reefs, seagrass beds, mangrove systems. There's a whole range of habitats that are protected in this zoning plan. We look at the inshore reefs of the marine park, Palm Islands, Whitsunday Islands, Keppel Islands primarily. We've seen really strong effects of the reserves, particularly for the things that we fish. Number one amongst them is coral trout. They're a really iconic species and they're really highly targeted by both commercial fishers on the offshore reefs and recreational fishers where we are here in the islands. We're looking at the impacts of recreational fishing and the impacts of the zoning plan and how those two things are interacting, really, to impact fish stocks. So we've seen a big increase in coral trout populations within the areas that are closed to fishing. Meanwhile, in the areas that are open to fishing, populations have been relatively stable. So when we look at the entire population, focusing on the inshore reefs, we can see that there's about 20 to 100% more fish in the entire system now than what there was in the early 1980s. A 50 centimetre coral trout may produce 10 times more babies than a 35 centimetre coral trout. So we're getting a lot more egg production coming from those bigger fish within the reserves. Those babies that are being produced are not staying within the reserve, they're being dispersed out. We're using some genetic tools to match babies back to mums and dads, and some of them are going a few hundred k's, and some of them are going a few hundred metres. So we're getting benefits across a range of distances from the populations within the reserves. From my point of view, what we're doing is keeping fishermen out of certain areas, so we should be looking at it as part of the fishery management strategy. It's not just a feel-good conservation thing and make nice places for tourists to go and look at big fish. It's more than that. Those big fish are valuable. They're much more valuable in the water producing babies than they are on somebody's dinner table.
You can't just keep taking and taking and taking and expect the ocean to keep producing. It's not working. Species now that are on the brink of extinction because of overfishing. So we need these sanctuary zones for somewhere for these fish to go and breed. Photography is a very powerful tool. It has the ability to show people who don't have the ability to go scuba dive how beautiful it is down there and such a wonderful place it is. And it shows them how fragile the underwater world is. It's very important for the local dive industry that we protect the grey nurse sharks. We get a lot of tourists coming here wanting to dive with the sharks, and virtually every weekend the boats are going there. And quite often we'll do two dives because people just want to dive with them. About 3-4 weeks ago, I was in taking photos, doing surveys of the grey nurse sharks. And I took a photo of a 2.5 metre plus female who was actually quite pregnant that was first photographed in 2007 and 2008 at Seal Rocks. It was a juvenile. And now, 8 years later, it's an adult with a baby.
The data we have is for coral reefs, and there's lots of other people working in Tasmania and New South Wales and Western Australia that are looking beyond coral reefs. Some places which are set aside for certain iconic species like grey nurse shark, which have been historically really overfished, and they've been bouncing back in recent decades. And some of that is by protecting the places that are most important, where we know that those sharks gather to either breed or to rest on migratory routes.
We should protect the sea, and in particular in this area. Our tourism does depend on it. It's not just part of our psyche and getting out there and being part of nature, but it's a really big, vital part of our actual livelihoods as well.
Where they have marine reserves and where the underwater world is protected draw eco-tourists, and eco-tourists spend on average 9 times more than your average tourist. Marine reserves are absolutely vital to businesses like our dive business, because our product is what you see underwater. If there's nothing to see, then people don't go.
We actually have fringing coral on the reefs, which is a microcosm of the Great Barrier Reef, and it's completely accessible, so close to the mainland that it's accessible by everybody. So therefore, it probably is potentially in danger of being loved to death. We run Sar Capricornia in Yeppoon on the Capricorn Coast, and we are at the bottom extremity of the Great Barrier Reef, and the reef marine park and the reef environment is very important to our business. So I grew up in this area and the culture's changed from when I was a child. The culture's definitely changed in this area. I think there is a little bit more that can be done. We see a lot of people doing the wrong thing at various times, and there is no enforcement here apart from the really busy times when the park's boat is out and about. Apart from that, it's pretty much policed by the commercial operators in this area.
I'm a small business operator in central Queensland in Yeppoon, and have operated my own sailing school business for 8 years, and also run a recreational fishing charter business as well. I think Australians, by their very nature, are freedom oriented. They want to have the freedom to explore and fish and camp and go out into the wilds, and they really value that. There's a two-edged sword when it comes to sanctuaries and protection mechanisms, because one thing makes it feel limiting and the other thing allows you to enhance the experience.
When the marine park was rezoned back in 2004, I guess there was a lot of community angst about not understanding why they needed to have so many sanctuary zones.
If people don't value those fish living within the reserves, and if they don't understand that those fish are valuable to the sustainability of the entire fish stock, then they're not going to respect the reserves. They're going to be in there poaching it, and any benefit that accrues within those reserves is going to be nullified. We've done quite a lot of work with the recreational fishing community down in the Keppel Bay area, and you know, more or less offered these people to come out and fish in the reserves with us. You know, we're going to catch these fish, we're going to tag them, we're going to take a little DNA fin clip, and then we're going to put them back into the water and give them a kiss goodbye. The two-way conversations that we would have was really insightful for both the researchers involved and also for the fishers. Many of these guys have been fishing this area their whole life. They know the reefs, they know the place. We see what's under the water and they know what comes out of it.
I believe it's important that the community gets an understanding of the importance of science in understanding the environment and particularly the water environment. They need to have that knowledge there in order to make decisions that will ensure that resource remains there for a long time to come.
I like fishing recreationally. I don't purposely just do it for science or whatever, but I feel if a part of me going out enjoying the recreational fishing and contributing to the science factor with tagging programs, I'm all for it.
With the fishing community, there's a reticence to be involved in anything that's regulatory. But in reality, once they understand what the science is doing and how the protection mechanisms impact on them, and if they get involved in those protection mechanisms, then they have a stronger bond to the protections and what they're doing, and they're more likely to protect them in the future.
I used to have the look of, you know, fish are fish, so what? Catch them, eat them, yippee, nothing to it. I can just remember back to my first dive and seeing the environment and thinking to myself, this is beautiful, it's amazing. Words fail me to try and describe it. And it changed my outlook on fish completely. It's definitely our job as parents, as fishermen, so that our children and their children can enjoy the sport of fishing, that we educate everyone on how important sustainable fishing in marine parks and everything to do with the water, how important it is.
Thank you.
I've had a fairly good look around the world, and I've just noticed that there's no places that are still as wild and beautiful adjacent to a pristine coral reef anywhere. So I think it's just such a valuable product right on our doorstep. Well, we get a range of tourists. They come from all around the country, right across the nation. A lot of families with young children just want to get them out to nature. They want to get them away from the iPods and the TVs. On the length of the coastline at Warra, adjacent to the World Heritage Area, there's places where there's sanctuary zones, where there's no fishing allowed, and there's other places where people recreational fish. We give the message out to people when they arrive what our ethos is about catching fish. Ideally, we'd like you just to take one fish a day. We don't believe we own anything. We just believe we're caretakers here for a little short period of time. If each one of us just took care of our own little patch, this planet would be a much better place.
Research around the globe and certainly here is starting to show us that manta rays are likely to be quite an important indicator species on the health of the reef, and having those animals continue to come back is a very good indicator that the health of the system is stable. In the time that I've been studying mantas in this particular area, I look at mantas within two sanctuary zones and have found that whilst they utilise those sanctuary zones, they do spend a lot of their time outside of those sanctuary zones. It is nice to have a sanctuary zone that is protected so that they can come back, obtain the services that they need. They visit fixed locations where cleaner wrasse and long-finned bannerfish live. They come out, pick off parasites, keep them clean. It would be really nice to be able to incorporate some of these additional cleaning stations that we've now discovered into the sanctuary network, purely on the grounds of protecting a manta's habitats. In visiting and researching some of these cleaning stations, we realised it's not just a single species that utilises them. We can have encounters with dugong, larger shark, turtles. Animals don't die of old age. They basically get infections and get sick and then get eaten by fast predators. So they do need to keep clean to maintain their health so they can outrun predators. If you don't maintain the health of those cleaning stations, they can lose their effectiveness. One of the ways to maintain the health of a cleaning station is to prevent fishing from around it. It is quite important, I think, in future reviews to start looking at these really important critical habitats, if you like, which are cleaning stations, because you do need a lot of them when you have a lot of animals. So they need to be rezoned, I suppose, at some point and put into, if possible, those wider sanctuary zones. We are very well placed here with what we've inherited, for starters, with the magnificent natural resource. We have managed, I think, to get in with a good system of sanctuary zones early in the piece, before it's been recognised as such a magnificent area that then attracts lots of people. With local knowledge and people on the ground out there appreciating it on a daily basis, we should be able to maintain what we have and keep it there for tourists to continue seeing.
It's important to protect at least representative examples of all habitats, whether they're close shoreline habitats, where the vast majority of sanctuary zones are in Australia, to right across the continental shelf and out and beyond. A part of that's being encompassed in the new Commonwealth Marine Reserve Network around Australia. Commonwealth Marine Reserves Network is the next big exciting step in marine conservation in Australia.
So sanctuaries and protection zones are not restrictions. They're actually enhancements. So they help the community to have a long-term sustainable recreational tourism, fishing, and boating industry.
Sanctuary zones play an important role in looking after our fish resources. If nothing else, they act as an insurance policy, because if things do go wrong and do run into problems with the resources that have got nothing to do with fishing but may have things to do with climate change, with long drought periods, those sanctuary zones do play a role in ensuring that we have some level of fish stocks that are protected, and those fish stocks can be important into the future.